Quantum mechanics is the most fundamental theory of physics, so it is no surprise that it can be formulated in very general terms. And with our experience from the one-dimensional problems and the introduction of a convenient general compact language, we can now formulate this in a few short postulates. This concerns four aspects of the theory: the quantum states, the observables, the dynamics, and measurements, where the last one really fixes how we utilize and interpret our results. I present them here in a form that covers all the really general aspects. One can later add some further assumptions, say from special relativity, or what happens if you deal with several fundamentally identical indistinguishable particles. But what we want to do here is to fix the most general requirements that really define the theory. So our first postulate concerns the possible states of the system. We say that these are vectors in a Hilbert space. This means that we can combine them linearly according to the superposition principle, and we have a scalar product to work out the length of a state, say for normalization, and compare any pair of states, in particular figure out if they are orthogonal. That's all there is really to say about these states in general terms. Depending on the system, the states may come in different incarnations, such as wave functions with one or more spatial coordinates, and sometimes they are indeed really just vectors with discrete components, as we will see for spin. But in terms of general constraints, we have already specified all that we need for these states. All the other features are just consequences. In particular, using the scalar product, we can also give a separate sense to the symbol of the dual state, and we will convert this into the scalar product whenever it meets a normal quantum state in this order here. Our next postulate concerns the observables. We demand that these are linear Hermitian operators. Linear just means that they will never involve to take, say, the square of a state or some other function of it. This really isn't defined for these vectors. And Hermitian we already defined as a property of these operators in relation to the scalar product. Now, the consequence of this is that the eigenvalues of these operators are real and that eigenstates with different eigenvalues are orthogonal to each other, as we have already proved before. And we use this to show that we can then write these operators in terms of these quantities in a very compact form, assuming for the moment that the eigenvalues are discrete and non-degenerate. Now, it may also happen that the eigenvalues cover a range of real numbers, or that there is a combination of both. Parts of the sum may therefore sometimes be replaced by an integral. And there are cases where different eigenstates have the same eigenvalues, but while this implies some interesting physical insights into these systems, all of this will never result in any real complications. Finally, just as we can compare different states by the scalar product, we can use the commutator to compare different observables. And we already described what this implies for the sets of eigenstates. We will expand on this point very soon when we have listed the other postulates. So, thirdly, we stipulate that there is a particular operator, which we call the Hamiltonian, which generates the dynamics of the state. So, tells us how it changes over time. And it does so by the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, which now reads as given here. Our physical interpretation of the Hamiltonian is to say that this is the observable for energy. So to the very least, any quantum system has this observable. As indicated, the Hamiltonian can itself depend on time. And furthermore, time here appears as a parameter. In quantum mechanics, time is not an observable. That explains the need for this separate postulate. Now, besides the nature of the quantum states, say if it is a function or a vector with just a few components, the Hamiltonian is really what distinguishes one quantum system from another, as we have seen already in our one-dimensional examples. So now comes the last postulate, which is really the one that gives sense to all the other aspects. And that's the rule of how we use them to make predictions about such systems. It consists of several parts. Firstly, measurements concern observables. So to any apparatus, you can assign an observable as defined in the second postulate. Secondly, the possible outcomes of the measurements, the values that you can read off your apparatus, are restricted to the eigenvalues of this observable. Thirdly, these outcomes are probabilistic and up to overall normalization occur with a probability given by the absolute value squared of the scalar product between A and Psi, where A is the eigenstate that corresponds to the value that you have observed. And finally, right after the measurement, the quantum state has changed and now coincides with this eigenstate A that corresponds to the observed value. So, as a matter of fact, the coefficient A psi is the scalar product between the states after and before the measurement. I assumed here that the eigenvalue is non-degenerate. Now this finally matters, but otherwise you just have to sum up the probabilities. And the resulting final state is the mathematical projection of the pre-measurement state psi onto the resulting subspace of degenerate eigenstates. So all remains well defined. It is also useful to mention that the coefficients A psi are really the expansion coefficients of the quantum state in the basis A, so the eigenbasis of the observable that you have measured, and therefore the measurement process itself looks like a projection onto one of these eigenstates. This drastic effect of the measurement is also known as the collapse of the wave function. It is really worthwhile to contemplate these points and appreciate their deep nature. This last rule on measurements determines what questions you can really ask about a quantum system and what you can hope to obtain as an answer. And it has three important parts. It tells us what the values are that we can observe, which notably can be quantized, and that they occur probabilistically. And it also tells us that a really good measurement, where you try to find out which value occurs in a single given observation, necessarily has a large effect on the quantum system. I tried to phrase this last aspect in a way so that it doesn't sound all too surprising. And indeed, some of this is borne out if you consider quantum theory that includes the measurement apparatus in its description. And at this point, at least, we also encounter a reassuring certainty, namely that once we have determined the measurement value, we can be sure that the system now is in the corresponding eigenstate. And if you would repeat the measurement straight away, you will simply get the same result and remain in this state. So it could have been worse. Measurements are useful. But still, this postulate is somewhat puzzling. Why do we need to replace the dynamics of the Schrödinger equation by something else when we do a measurement? As a matter of fact, as mentioned, you can include the measurement apparatus in your description, and you then find that its state becomes strongly correlated with the quantum system. This is really good. It's actually a manifestation of a quantum phenomenon that we will discuss later, entanglement, the arguably deepest and most fascinating of all quantum phenomena. And this observation really explains a lot, but you could still ask about the way the result then affects the rest of the world. Say, the person who reads off the value. This is a really tricky question. And calling this the collapse of the wave function highlights that this still leaves some puzzles. In the early stages, people were indeed wondering about the role of the observer, and you may also have heard of the idea of many worlds, all attempts to address this question from a somewhat metaphysical angle. In any case, personally, I find it comforting that quantum mechanics both suggests that not everything is predetermined, but then throws up measurements where we get some certain knowledge. And the remaining puzzles are mainly conceptual. From a practical perspective, all of this is overshadowed by the fact that with these postulates, quantum mechanics becomes an incredibly predictive theory of nature that has been verified in detail and found to be exceedingly accurate, without any known contradictions, which is the real scientific test for any theory, metaphysical questions apart. So, as a fundamental theory that applies to the world, it is well defined and both very general as well as practically useful. Of course, it may someday be supplanted by something even more fundamental and hopefully still well defined, general and useful, if not similarly beautiful. But for now, it is really the best theory that we have. Its perhaps biggest puzzle is why it is so successful. Okay, so now let us directly look at some general consequences of our postulates. The most important one is about expectation values. We encountered a powerful shortcut, given here, first just by way of illustration for position and momentum, but then we gave a mathematical proof of this when we developed the general mathematical language. The only missing bit was to say that A psi squared is indeed the probability, and we now have elevated this to a postulate. Furthermore, we mentioned that such steps can also be carried out to give a bound on the resulting uncertainties of pairs of observables. And now that we are sure that these uncertainties are really defined in terms of expectation values, we can use this to make statements about measurements. The most important one is that if two observables do not commute, we cannot find any state in which they both have certain values. We call these pairs incompatible observables, and with position and momentum have already encountered the archetypical example. If two observables do commute, we call them simultaneous observables. You can then indeed design an apparatus that measures them both. The final state after the measurement is then a joint eigenstate, and the outcomes are the associated eigenvalues of the two operators. This can actually reveal some very interesting correlations of these outcomes. Indeed, there are many situations where you combine simultaneous observables to remove any ambiguity about the states, which may arise from degenerate eigenvalues. As a matter of fact, a set of simultaneous observables is often used as the starting point to define the possible states of a quantum system. And we will apply this logic soon when we will turn to three-dimensional systems. There are some other very general conclusions that we could draw from these postulates, such as how this works exactly in three spatial dimensions, as well as about the dynamics of the system and what happens in composed systems, say of several particles, but these form their own chapters in the rest of the course. Next, I want to give us some more practice with the general language that we have developed. This allows us to introduce a very general method to describe complex quantum systems by simpler variants. This is known as perturbation theory. And there we can use our previous one-dimensional examples to show how this approach works in practice. Right after this, we then turn to the three-dimensional case.